God is with us, and the people say, here we find new life. Good morning. Welcome to First Church Simsbury. Whatever your age, whomever you love, no matter your income, whatever the color of your skin, whatever your abilities, your state of physical, emotional, mental, or spiritual health, God welcomes you here, and so do we. Welcome to longtime members and new visitors. Welcome to those watching from home. You are with us in spirit. Here we like to say, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you belong here. My name is Rev Kev. I'm joined by my senior colleague, Pastor George Harris. We have just heard from our Director of Music Ministries, Mark Mercier, and of course, from Jim Martocio, who joins us on saxophone. And in just a little while, we'll hear from our chancel choir up there in the balcony, in the choir loft. This morning, our head usher is Anthony in the back. If you have any questions about bathrooms or how to get down to coffee hour afterwards, you can talk to Anthony or anyone really will help you out, but that's his job this morning. So this morning, after our call to worship, pre-K through grades 4 and then 5 to 7 are also invited downstairs for church school. Everyone is welcome there, all children, for our godly play curriculum. Our teachers are ready to go. And then afterwards, everyone, we're all welcome to join down for fellowship hour, for conversation. Today is the first Sunday of November, and what that means in our church year is that this is All Saints Sunday. So we will give God thanks today for all the saints, those who have passed from this life to the next, those who are still living. I mentioned in the weekly email, folks could bring objects. So I don't know if y'all don't read the weekly email or you just felt like not bringing objects. I don't know. There's just a couple up here. So if you have brought an object and you would like to bring it forward, you could do that. Or if you want to hold on to it, that's fine. Or you could have an object on your heart. That is just as well this morning. But something that represents a saint, someone who has been a saint in your life. And then also, so that's those are the living saints. And then also we will think about and consider and reflect upon, give God thanks for those saints that have died specifically in this past year, the saints of our church. So let us now push away all that might distract us from being present here during this hour of worship, and let's be together in the spirit of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for this opportunity to be together in this space to worship you. We ask that you be with us, that you help us to hear your voice and your word through the music and the scripture, and that we might leave here with strength and faith. It's in your holy name that we pray. Amen.
Invite the children to please come forward for a children's message, and you can see you have a little bit smaller spot to gather, and I don't have my step to sit on, so I'm gonna sit here, but you guys can all fill in right here in front of me. Thank you. So I don't know if you heard what Rev Kev said up there. He said, this is All Saints Day. And a saint is somebody either who is alive and that we know, or somebody who has passed on to heaven, who serves as an example for us about how to live. and how to be faithful to God. And I'm going to show you a couple pictures of saints, and then I'm going to give you a mission. Okay? Only you can see this. Not everybody else can see this. So these are two saints in the church. And I'm not even going to give you their names, okay? So here's one. Okay? You see that? And then here's another. So I want you to divide up in groups of two. 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. Maybe about six of you on each as a team, and go out and find these two people and ask them their names. How about that? Some of you might be shy, and it might not be for you, and some of you aren't shy at all, so this is a good mission for those of you who aren't shy at all. Let me show you their pictures again, okay? Okay, so you're going to look for that person, and if you need some adult help, you can get it, but I bet you can figure this out. And then here's the other person. And tell me what your mission is. Find them and ask them their name, and then come back here. Okay, and I'm going to ask for their name. You got it? Okay, on your mark, get set, go. Don't be shy. You got it. Okay, did you find both? Did you buy? Well, go, come on back. If you got both names, don't come back without a name. Okay, so I think some of you have both names, so we can come back now, and I think you guys got it. So let me, so what are the two names that you learned? You remember? What is it? Uh-oh. Eileen, and how about the other one? I saw you back there with her. Yes. Did I show you the picture of two women? Do you really think one is named Bob? You remember the other one? Who wants to run back there and ask? I know you know where she is. I'll point her out to you. You want to go? Okay, all the way back in that, right on the aisle there with the glasses. Go. On the left. All the way. Go, 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 go. Nope. Warmer, warmer, warmer. All the way, all the way. Ask her her name. What is it?
Marianne.
Yes! Woohoo! That was harder than I thought. Saint Eileen and Saint Marianne. And they're just two. In fact, I'm sure there is a Saint Bob in this church. Okay? In fact, I see one right there. There's Saint Bob right there. So in fact, we have a whole church of saints. And in fact, I'm going to point out another saint to you. Who do you see? Who's that? That's you. God made you as examples for each other and for everybody else. So you are all saints. You're the youngest saints, and you're still being kind of formed. Everybody is created in the image of God, and everybody's a saint. High five. Yes. All right. So, saints, all of you, you can now follow your saintly leader to church school. And I invite all of you to stand for the call to worship. We remember, O God,
the countless saints of history who have blazed a trail of courage through time.
We remember, O God,
the tender touch of loved ones, the example of heroes, the healing words of comforters, the remarkable acts of fearless ones.
We remember, O God,
the gentle strength of grandparents, the loyalty of friends, the kindness of strangers, the joy of children, the sacrifice of parents.
We remember, O God,
the supreme love of Jesus, continued through generations of disciples, young and old, dead and living, articulate and silent, strange and familiar, brilliant and ordinary.
We remember in every time and place the saints of God who have shown us the Lord.
Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us worship God with joy.
Please be seated. As we do each week, let us join together now in our unison prayer of confession. Most merciful God, whose word is a lamp for our feet and a light for our path, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and follow in your ways to the glory of your name. Let's keep silent for our silent sins, our quiet acts of ignorance, and our indifference to the suffering around us. God wants us to be whole and at peace. So God takes our sin, forgives our sin, and greets us with mercy and with grace. For this we give thanks to God. Amen. Scripture this morning comes from Revelation chapter 7, verses 2 through 4 and 9 through 17. I saw another angel ascending from the rising of the sun with the seal of the living God, and he called with a loud voice to the four angels who had been given power to damage the earth and the sea, saying, "Do not damage the earth and the sea or the trees until we have marked the servants of our God with a seal on their foreheads." And I heard the number of those who were sealed, 140,000, sealed out of every tribe of the people of Israel. After this, I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne of the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried in a loud voice, they cried out, Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, Amen. Blessed and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from? I said to him, Sir, you are the one who knows. And he said to me, These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God, and they worship him day and night and within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will guide them to springs of the water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. These are holy words. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Now, O God, take my lips and speak through them. Take our minds and think through them. Take our hearts and set them on fire with your love. Amen. This past September, beginning of September, I officiated a wedding here, and having known the groom and the groom's family for many years, I was honored to attend the reception. And when I arrived at that reception hall, I ran into a small group of people, some of whom I knew, and began talking with them immediately. In that group was a man I recognized but could not quite place. As the conversation continued, I finally said, Okay, I know you from somewhere. I asked, Where do I know you from? He said, I'm a saint. I said, What? He said, In your church, I'm a saint. What? Suddenly, it hit me. Last spring, we explained to our confirmation class, like we do each year, that in our tradition, saints are living and dead. And we asked our confirmands the names of some people that they see as living saints that we could invite to confirmation class. Confirmand Lucas Kosbinski, a scout in the Avon troop, encouraged us to invite troop leader Brad Mead, who accepted the invitation. As a practicing Catholic, Mr. Mead got a special kick out of the invitation. After all, one of the qualifications for being a saint in the Catholic Church is you must be dead. In the Catholic tradition, saints lived heroically virtuous lives and offered their lives to others. Some were martyred for the faith, and all worthy of imitation. In their death, these saints can intercede with life here on earth. For example, if you bury a statue of Joseph the carpenter upside down in your yard, he will help you sell your house. There is nothing wrong with this belief. I'm not making fun of it. It is, however, slightly different from our Protestant belief that all Christians, living or dead, are saints. It is also why Mr. Mead found the whole thing to be so funny. Mr. Mead laughed as he shared with me how, as I walked to the chancel area at the beginning of the wedding ceremony, he leaned over to his son and said, "That priest thinks I'm a saint." Today, as we do each year on the first Sunday in November, we celebrate All Saints Sunday. Most of us gather here needing clarification about who qualifies as a saint. While we aren't Catholic, many of us, like Mr. Mead, carry this understanding that saints are a select few dead people who lived exemplary lives and intercede on our behalf. In our Protestant tradition, however, saints exist among the living and the dead. Living saints are, as we say during the invitation to Holy Communion, all who seek to follow in Christ's way. So ask yourself this honest question. Do you seek to follow in Christ's way? My guess is most of you do. If the answer is yes, then you are a saint. There is scripture to back this up. In his letters to the churches in Corinth and Ephesus, the Apostle Paul addresses to all the people of those who the churches as saints, to the saints and faithful brethren in Corinth, "Grace to you and peace from God our Father," he writes. And the Old Testament writers addressed God's people as holy ones. All God's people are holy, loosely. All God's people are saints. Of course, the Bible also tells us that all God's people are sinners too. And as we prayed in this morning's unison prayer of confession, we all fall short of God's glory in word and deed, and I love this line, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. But that doesn't take away from our role as saints. We are also saints because we can reflect God's love in this world. We are complex people. We can tell the truth, spread kindness, advocate for justice, and help others to stand up for themselves. We can do good things even when we have done bad things. When we look at the scriptures and one of the most famous gospels, we come across Matthew. When Jesus asked Matthew to follow him, many were astonished. Matthew had worked for the Roman government as a tax collector. Tax collectors, of course, we know, were notorious for charging citizens much more than they owed. These tax collectors often bullied and threatened individuals to collect the money that they wanted. Tax collectors were among society's lowest. However, Jesus selected Matthew as one of the original 12 apostles to carry the good news across the region. Even those we label or see as the lowest of the low are essential to God and can be used for God's purposes. Today, on All Saints Sunday, we remember all the saints and sinners who have been part of our lives. In the weekly email, as I mentioned, I asked folks to bring an object that reminds you of someone important in your life, living or dead, who has been crucial on your spiritual journey, for your spiritual journey, a saint, if you will. I brought a box. It is a box that my grandfather gave to me. It is a box that his grandfather, or actually a grandfather-like figure in his life, gave to him. The man's name was Gideon Groff, who sold horse insurance. This was Gideon Groff's horse insurance cash box. My grandfather told me how Gideon would sit with him and tell him stories, ask him questions. He took an interest in his life. This obviously made an impression on my grandfather. He listened, and I later realized as I grew that as Gideon listened to my grandfather listened to me. And so when I see this box, I think of the people like my grandfather, who shared their stories with me and sought to understand mine. On this table are also candles. As has become tradition, we light candles and name the folks of this church and the family and friends of folks in this church who have passed in the last year. As we light these unique candles, we remember each person in their uniqueness, their smiling faces, their hearts, their souls, and the influence they had on our lives as our saints. Our reading this morning is from Revelation. It is one of the few biblical verses about a vision, people who have gone to heaven. The imagery is highly symbolic, and it's difficult to decipher. However, there is a clear assurance in the word and in the imagery that God's love surrounds us even after death. In the passage, the author writes about some people praising God. Standing around the throne, the elder responds, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal, and they are in God's care, where no more harm can come to them." These are they. I like that phrase. These are they who made a difference. These are they who live in God's care even now. These are they, the saints, living and dead, whom we love. These are they who took and take risks. These are they who were and are ordinary, flawed people, but were and are significant nonetheless. These are they that didn't and don't have supernatural powers or abilities, but showed up and stood up with us and stand up with us when we need them and when the world needs them. These are they that have shaped us and shape our lives and made and make us who we are as individuals, and therefore shape what kind of community we are. These are they that taught us and teach us to take risks so that we at one time wandered into this church for the first time. These are they that taught and teach us to be kind, to be fair, and to reach out to the world's needs. It is essential to remember and thank God for all the saints because they remind us of who we want to be. And when we drift a little off course, All Saints Day helps us correct a course, practice gratitude, which leads to a more joyful and less self-centered life. Who are these? These are they who had and have stories, who had and have flaws, yet somehow us ordinary folks, for all the saints, we give thanks today. And while you're at it, tell your family and friends, like Mr. Mead, that you too are a saint. Because while these are they, you are also they. As we mentioned, these candles represent all of those who have passed from this life to the next, all of those members of the church, friends of the church, friends of members of the church, family of members of the church. And at the end of our time together, we will welcome folks to call additional names out loud. Sandra Antonelli. Pauline Bender Hall, Diana Woodbury, Jake Betts,
Helen Bidwell, Stephen Bonner, Nellie Branson,
Kevin Burke. Nancy Carpenter. Gertrude Conroy.
Richard Catone. Ruth Edwards. Babs Gardner.
Janet Grevstad. Abby Harris. Seth Harris.
Carol Hurstein. Carol Hurstein. Betty Huckey. Roy Huckey.
Helen Tedder Kennedy. Audrey Minnick. Elaine Petron.
Manny Sirakis. Nancy Roby. Warren Rothman.
Robert Shogren. Barbara Sudnick. Elsie White.
Carla Wild. Rick Wild. Todd Williams. John Yoakum. In the silence that follows, I invite you to name either in your heart or aloud the names of those saints in your lives that have passed from this life to life eternal. Don't worry if you land on top of each other. We're just lifting all the names up among us and to God. I invite you to name these.
Marshall.
now enter into a time of prayer together. I will begin by praying for all of you who grieve, however you grieve, recognizing that whether that's very fresh or has extended over a lifetime, that's very poignant and real and also reflects the great love that you still hold for whatever loved one you lost. So we lift all of that before God. In particular, we pray for Kathy Wildman and the Wildman family after the passing of Kathy's father, Roy Huckey. And I know Roy passed not long after Kathy, your mom, Betty, also passed. I'm told it's a beautiful love story and that they just couldn't stand to be apart, so they're now together again. And it's nice to see you both back in church, so welcome. For the family of Nancy Roby, Nancy Roby's memorial service was held here in the sanctuary yesterday, so we pray for the Roby family, recognizing that that grief is still very fresh. We pray for Jim White, the father of Bill White. He moved here to Connecticut to be near Bill and not long after fell and was hospitalized and has now entered rehab, 94 mm-hmm. years young. So we pray for Jim and his full recovery. Of course, we're praying for peace, Israel and Gaza and across the world for just the awful violence, of course, but also the way this has continued to divide and hurt all who are touched by it in some way or another. We don't forget the Ukraine and Russia and pray for peace there as well. I turn to you now and invite you to name those prayers that might be on your hearts this morning, prayers of that weigh you down or also prayers of joy or celebration, good news that you would like to share. Yes, Joy. Christ and our angels, that they walk with us and bring us peace. Thank you. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Holy One, you are our God and we are your people. And we are grateful that you have claimed us as your own. You have set us in the company of saints past and present among those who have made bold witness to your goodness and your truth. Your word opens up new futures where we see no way forward. You know the places in our hearts where we are afraid of a future we cannot control, afraid of losing health and independence, afraid for the well-being of children and loved ones, afraid that past mistakes will ruin our future. Write the stories of your people deep into our hearts so that we may learn to trust you beyond our fears. Give us hearts and minds and spirits ready to trust and follow wherever your spirit leads. Confident that you will not lead us beyond your loving embrace. We ask in Jesus' name, whose outstretched arms welcome us and hold us securely in your grace. Amen.
First, we are beginning our church school holiday drive down outside Palmer Hall at coffee hour, you will see, well, and then Heather just walked in. So you will see Heather down there this morning, and she will have information for you about that holiday drive. We are collecting hats, gloves, mittens, and cash so that we can purchase items to fill care bags for kids that need the extra help in our Simsbury schools. 2 weeks away, but I really would love you to save the date, Simsbury's Interfaith Thanksgiving Service. We are the hosts this year. It moves around to different churches in Simsbury. We are hosting it this year. All the churches in Simsbury participate. It's a lovely, feel-good time together. Lots of music, lots of good energy. And that is on Sunday the 19th, 2 weeks from today at 6 p.m. right here. Also, we'll note that our stewardship campaign continues. You have pledge cards in your bulletins. I understand we are at 44%, which isn't bad. And it means that there are still a number of you who have not yet responded, so please don't wait. And that way, it doesn't get carried on and on and on. I do invite our stewardship speaker, Bennett Stafford, up to share a word with us. Sure.
I was tasked by Rev Kev to talk about why I feel like First Church is a great spiritual home. I feel like this church isn't just about God's rules and things like that. I feel like it's also about God's love. First Church is welcoming and accepting, and I've noticed here that the leaders of this church, these wonderful two, really enjoy the interaction with its members in the services. And that's a very nice feeling. When you walk in here, everything from the style of the building, color on the walls, music inside, and smiles on the people's faces in the pews make it feel lively and bright, which is very nice again. My most recent positive experience here, which I think I talked about a couple weeks ago, was after the junior fellowship overnight lock-in. The next morning after I got dressed, I was a bit restless when I woke up, so I happened to walk by the kitchen downstairs, where we all gather after the services, where some of the soup was being made. Now, I've tasted the soup before, it's very delicious. So, yes, I asked to help, and then for about 30 minutes, I ended up dicing potatoes for the soup, which was very, very nice as well. When I was done, I went back upstairs to join my parents for the church service that was being held. And afterwards, when we all met to eat and fellowship, and I tasted that delicious soup, I think it felt good that I had something to do with it. I had a part with it. I think that's the best way to summarize it. The loveliness, the feeling of how it feels to be here at First Church of Christ in Simsbury. It leaves you with a sense of positive. It leaves you with a positive and warm feeling. I think it's a good place to grow spiritually, surrounded by kindness and caring. Okay, bye-bye.
That's great, Bennett. Thank you. Brian Noga was a hard act to follow last week, and Bennett, you did it, so thank you for that. I'm going to bring the tithing box forward and put it in the center here. Those of you who have been here in recent weeks know that we will invite you forward to either put your weekly offering or your pledge card into the tithing box. You may also put a visitor card or a prayer card. You can also remain prayerfully in your seat. All of those are entirely valid options. So please use this time to just reflect prayerfully on some of the things that Bennett said, what the church means to you, and that lovely feeling that I trust that so many of us find here. So we will now receive this morning's offering. Thank you. Gracious and loving God, please take these, our gifts, each of us humble saints, not perfect, but committed to you, to walk in your ways. Please put these gifts to your service. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please be seated. We gather for Holy Communion, and as we do, we remember that we are welcome here, all who seek to follow in Christ's way. We come to this table not because we must, but because we may. We come to this table not to express an opinion, but to seek a presence, God's presence. We come to this table just as we are. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. All who come to me shall not hunger, and all who believe in me shall never thirst. And so it is with Christians around the world and throughout the centuries that we gather around these symbols of bread and of cup, simple elements that speak of nourishment and transformation. So come, you who have much faith and you who have little. You who have been here often and you who have not been here for a long time. Come with your doubts, come with your hopes, come with your inadequacies, come with your strengths. Come not because we invite you, but because Jesus does. It is his hope that those who seek him should meet him here.
Let us pray. Holy One, our loving Creator, close to us as breathing and distant as the farthest star. We thank you for your constant love for everything in your creation and for all that sustains life. We are grateful, O God, for all people of faith in every generation, for all those that have come before, for all who have given themselves to your will. We are especially grateful, O God, for Jesus Christ, who teaches us how to live out an ethic of justice and peace, and for the calling of your church that keeps his mission alive. We ask you to bless this bread and this cup and bless us that as we receive them at this table, we may join with you in promoting the well-being of all creation. We pray in the name of our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, our sibling and friend, our mother and father, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's welcome in the church school kids. Come join us. On the night he was betrayed, while gathered with his friends and with his followers, Jesus took bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it. He said, "This is broken for you. Each time you eat of it, do so in remembrance of me." Ministering to you in Christ's name, we give you the bread.
Thank you.
take and eat.
In the same way, then, Jesus took the cup and, offering that before his disciples and before God and giving thanks, he said, "This cup represents my blood that will soon be spilled for each and all of you. This cup represents a new covenant, a new promise, a new commitment of unconditional love between God and between all of you, a commitment that will never, ever be broken." He said, "As often as you drink of this, do so in remembrance of me." Remembering that night, remembering Jesus, I now offer you the cup of blessing. You may take it as you receive it, remembering that even as we come before God as the body of Christ, God meets each of us in all our uniqueness and beauty. I offer you the cup.
to stand for our unison prayer of thanksgiving. Thanks be to you, O God, for your presence, loving kindness, and transforming spirit. May the blessings of this table strengthen our faith, call us to Christ's service,
and unify our hearts for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Go forth into the world to serve God with gladness. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.